everyone, and welcome to the day one of the 10th edition of the annual Academic Conference 2021, hosted by the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT Madras. A decade of deliberation has shown us the power that academic understanding and research can have in shaping the journey of humanity. Broadly themed spatiality, this conference will feature 7 panels, 5 keynote lectures, 19 speakers, and a unified attempt at academic development. The first panel for the conference and this morning will be Space and Personal in Literary Texts, moderated by Professor Divya of the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT Madras. I shall now introduce the panelists. Amrita P.U., a doctorate scholar from the University of Hyderabad, will be presenting her paper titled Gendered Mobilities and Spaces of Resistance and Adaptation in Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie's Novels. Following her, Noel Mariam George, a doctorate scholar in political science and international relations from Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT Madras, will be presenting on the topic Being With or Also, an exploration of intimate space in To the Lighthouse. The concluding speaker for this panel, Abdul Saman K, is unable to join due to medical reasons. Therefore, this will be the final presentation for the first panel. Panelists will be given 15 minutes to present the paper. Panelists who would like to present a presentation or paper to the audience, please inform your moderator and you'll be given presenter access. After the completion of all panelists, the moderator will ask their questions, followed by questions from the members of the panel, followed by members of the audience through the chat box. The session will conclude with the closing remarks by the moderator. The session is also being recorded for archival purposes. Use of derogatory or offensive language is strictly prohibited and will attract strict action. I now leave the floor to Professor Divya to moderate the panel, Space and Personal in Literary Texts.
Thank you, Devika. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to this first panel of our academic conference at IITM. The panel, as you know, is titled Space and the Personal in Literary Texts. Let me just introduce the two panelists for this discussion. The first panelist would be Amrita. Amrita is currently undertaking research in English literature at University of Hyderabad. From August 2019, she is a postgraduate in English literature from the English and Foreign Languages University, Hyderabad, and received JRF in December 2018. She has worked on modernist and postmodernist poetry and spatiality in modern fiction during her post-graduation. Currently, she's working on Nigerian diaspora author Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie from a colonial gendered perspective in reading space during displacement. Her area of research interest is post-colonial literature, focusing on the role of spatial narratives and shaping experiences of migration from material, psychological, and cultural dimensions. And she aspires to bridge a gap in spatial studies by devising a working model that parallels the spatiality and its effects on displacement. I now welcome Amrita to present her paper, which is titled Gendered Mobilities and Spaces of Resistance and Adaptation in Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie's Novels. Amrita, the floor is yours for the next 15 minutes.
Thank you. As she has rightly introduced, my paper title is Gendered Mobilities and Space of Resistance and Adaptation in Adichie's Novels. So I hope that you have all been able to access the abstract, and due to time constraints and in order to manage the paper in a better way, I have only taken like 2/3 of the abstract part into my main paper that I'm presenting today. And I have focused on 2 of her novels instead of all her the entire oeuvre of Adichie. And the novels that I've selected today to for this paper, for this particular paper, is Americana and Half of a Yellow Sun. So let me begin with the presentation. And I'm also sharing my paper to you so that you can also read along the major sections that I'm reading. Yeah. I hope the screen is visible for you. So Doreen Nassim observed that spaces are gendered in a myriad different ways which vary between cultures and over time, and she extended spatial studies into interdisciplinary research. So Mezzi's notion of spatiality considers space as a product of intersecting social relations and proposes an approach to places that essentially contextualizes the relationship between the conceptualization of space or place and the social construction of gender relations. So here I'm looking at the issue of transnational migration and the migration within the national boundaries and its homely or unhomely effects. So Adichie's position as a post-colonial feminist author, writing the experiences of women in mobility, addresses gender concerns equally with other conflicts, and it responds to displacement of women in the narratives, accommodating their doubly disadvantaged position as a displaced citizen and also from the gender point of view. So gender in mobility and the conventional gender studies and migration studies approach the issue of gender in mobility with a set of tropes that particularly emphasize the role of women and the impact it has on the continuous spectrum of migration across the globe. The International Organization of Migration observes that gender influences reasons for migrating, the exponents in destination, modes and networks in use, potential and resources foreseen in the destination, and also in the personal and public relationships with the country of origin. So here we try to study the difference in pattern of gender influence, I mean different group of women with varying material and cultural privileges, as we can see in Adichie's novel. And this will be with respect to the spatial parameters. And the paper introspects the expectations, relationships, and power dynamics associated with gender. And Adichie's narrative also tried to develop the concept of female bonding in unlikely circumstances during displacement. And here the particular emphasis is on feminine spaces and how they evolve and transform during the process of mobility. So there are conflicting voices of tradition and modernity around the roles of women who undergo the process of displacement. So being the nurturer in the traditional community and social structures, women had to order their everyday practical life for the convenience of family and for the ensuring their basic needs. So there are social expectations basically coming out of patriarchy, and also that of an order which demands a certain degree of typicality in their choice to migrate, either as an exile or a family or as a familial choice. So here I use the word typicality in the sense that Decatur uses in the practice of everyday life. So the typical ways in which the life are evolving and adapting and also performing as a resistance to the pertaining system of social production and capitalist system of the way in which the economic and the society performs. So Adichie represents an array of women characters whose mobility is in alignment with such expectations, whereas she also attempts to portray the new trends in women's mobility in need of material and emotional needs. So she's also considering how the practices and policy of origin country, the issues at the origin country is actually influencing this mobility. While there is a discrimination against women in their origin country, and while they are limited to the access to resources and educational opportunities, there occurs this problem of how the women migrate autonomously from their particular location, geographical or spatial locations. So gender relations within the family determine who migrates on their own, and the inappropriateness of women migrating autonomously, as we see in traditional communities. And this makes it difficult for women's participation in international migration. But Adichie here is actually demonstrating the changing perception about female migration, contrary to the conventional needs and practices, and points to a choice in the case of positive migration. So the data indicate that the rate of female migration is growing faster than male migration, and there is a process and a process that the migration studies are coining as feminization of migration. And Adichie is, while she's also talking about a choice that is involved in female migration, she's also trying to demystify the notion of choice in the neoliberal late capitalist migration from a gender perspective. So even in positive migration, the significance of female spaces as safe spaces is recurring in her writings. So in her transnational displacement narratives, she explores the emotional and physical spaces that are assumed by women as safe spaces, while they are also entering into vulnerabilities as in transracial marriages for the right to the new space. So this is where the right to the new space is used in the sense how the citizenship and space are connected. So psychological spaces that these women in mobility assume in relationships and marriages are the expression of program intentionality enforced through a new normal of the urban spaces they occupy. So while the aspiration quotient varies from women to women, there something that remains constant in the hierarchy is that emotional and sexual vulnerability in these kind of marital and relationships. And she is, I'm taking a case, a few instances from Adichie, the women, the tribal women Eberechi, the women who serves as a mistress to the army superior in Half of Yellowstone, Ifemelu, the central character in the novel, Americana, who had to tolerate the sexual exploitation from her employer, her aunt, who ends up in different marriages for a safer position in Americana, and the pregnant women who migrate to Americana from migrate to America from Nigeria for their deliveries. All of them express the relationship of these women in mobility with this displaced state of theirs, which is Nigeria. So Adichie also talk about a new slavery that women particularly face through transracial marriages and relationships. So they had to be sexually and emotionally available to men from superior power position, and they were supplicated by meager material needs, which was not easy for them to reject. So elaborating on Eberechi, she was exploited by army men, who is not only the women who were subjected to this treatment, but that actually shows an unstable social situation, and especially in the forefront of war. And they, while they are equally witnessing the violence acted upon their communities, they are also internally destabilized by the very little space they have for these thoughts and anxieties. I'm taking an instance from Half of Yellowstone, where the major character Olena, who had occupied a public, who is unable to occupy a public space during war, like her husband Otnik, even during their extreme points of vulnerability, because public spaces become more threatening to women in the context or in the pretext of a displacement. And this actually shows an internally and externally layered isolation that women in displacement experience in terms of spatial configuration. So while we are discussing a positive migration, there are the women are in disadvantageous position, but the risk and vulnerabilities in the forefront of a war, like in Half of Yellowstone, discusses the gender question with a difficulty. And the privileges also varies in the gender spectrum. And Adichie consider gender question migration in close relation to the spatial power dynamics by which their right to space, the public and private, are determined by the prevailing conditions of gender equation. So for an instance, she's taking a typical phrase from the third war narrative, where the enrage of women in the novel who are occupying different class and power position converge to a common point during the larger conflict. This occurs a common space. This occurs out of the necessity to provide care for their family. So while Olena and Ognigbo, who were living in their Nasuka household, the university city, they were actually having a better spatial privilege, but when they move out of it, Olena, along with her difficulty of displacement, she's burdened with the responsibility to find resources in terms of domestic space and its necessity. Kainin, on the other hand, her sister, had to raise the role of a caretaker for the entire refugee camp. So, and there is also characters like Mrs. Mukulu, who had to understand the basic, the spatial difficulties, and also ensure the functionality of the everyday life by undertaking and accommodating a large number of insurgent refugee families. And these responsibilities are without are done without being too conscious of practicing and or exercising a choice. So women in this displacement narratives were vulnerable, are also actually had no choice to either deny or delay their impending duty. So Adichie challenges the notion of women as appendages during forced migration, or their position as vulnerable baggage exposed and submissive to a patriarchal notion about women in conventional migration studies. So Half of Yellowstone is a tale of losses during the process of migration, and the novel also explores the radical shift in the life of the displaced subjects in terms of eternal and temporary losses. And these losses actually characterizes their rest life and the relationship with space. The reducing physical space from Nasuka, a university township, to Umohia, a refugee town or a city, a refugee village, where they have to move from a big house to a small house, from and then again to one-room quarters and to a refugee camp itself. There is a shrinking physical space, which is aligning with their worldview. So this actually illustrates Decartier's argument that everyday life works by process of poaching on territory of others, using the rules and products that already exist in culture in a way that is influenced but not determined wholly by the rules and products. It is through a physical and psychological distancing from this naturally bound behavior that the conflict arises in the narrative structure of this novel. So loss of the static spaces and their engagement with the spatial and cultural formats lead to certain in-between spaces, which are the spaces of adaptation in this novel. So the nobility and new cultural signs signal new identities, and the society here is one of loss and separation, and there occurs a defamiliarization due to the political conflict that occurs in the culture and practice of different communities and with respect to space. So Adichie is dealing with cultural mobility and transformation with respect to and familiarity and unfamiliarity. So the mobility involves a constant sense of unfamiliarity that is threatening and intimidating, and it can only be neutralized by rightly performing in between spaces. So these in between spaces or intermittent spaces can be transitional and temporary, and they can evolve according to the aspirations of the vulnerable to overcome the adversity. As an example for this kind of like an adaptation, so Adichie is looking at how the women are portraying the unfamiliar spaces and how they're adapting these unfamiliar spaces as well. So Olena starts in school in the courtyard of refugee camps. He is an intellectual from a privileged position, and the school buildings are rather actually being made into refugee camps. So the refugee camp dissolving into schools and school dissolving into refugee camps. So in the case of Americana, there is a positive migration in which the major character Ifemelu is moving out of the country for material reasons, but as well as there are political motives behind this kind of like a transformation. And there is a pattern of transcultural imperative in their identity formation with respect to their close cultural relationship and self-negotiation in the ambience of a new space. So this new space is symptomatic of the cultural and political shift they are performing in their lives. In Political Unconscious, Frederick Jameson proposes that a text in its relation to social condition of its time and space contains a historical correlative that determines the surface structures of the narrative. And here in Americana, Adichie brings the uncanny of racial and cultural conflicts in transcultural or cross-cultural ambience of Americana, along with the identity fissure that the lost and new space imparts to the migrant. So in discussion of migration, the intention or affinity to migrate in the displaced individual become a determinant factor, yet the choice we assume in the political precept of post-colonial communities like a wholesome availability to shape their speculation about this judgment. So they are rather forming a contact zones by which the intimacy and intimacy is formed in their association with the new spaces. So there are mental spaces that are constructed through cultural collusion, which actually help the immigrant identity to adapt both with their native and foreign essence. So Adichie's character exhibits a fluidity that represents the cultural and private transformation and the international relation that are likely to happen in the context of desired migration. So in Americana, Adichie utilizes an internet or blogosphere as peculiar spaces to access both their homelands and also the host cultures for women who have undergone migration. So she talks about women's globalized existence through mediated spaces such as social media. In an attempt, rather than condensing space into feminine and masculine spaces, Adichie is looking into feminine spaces through social practices, emotional association, and transformation to communal feeling, and that emulate as a space of resistance and claiming. These safe spaces that women envision and develop at the moment of crisis or mobility in Adichie's narratives indicate a feminine resistance in spatiality during displacement. So she's also talking about home, street, village, and other spatial motives through which this resistance is performed. And I'm taking the particular examples of home. And home act as a physical as well as mental space in Adichie. And the idea of home that Adichie put forth is not that of that of permanency, but it supports the concept of permanency of structure or architecture that incorporate the meaning of home in popular discourses. In this respect, space is Gaston Bachelard's phenomenological object. Meaning of the interior space in the narrative gets embodied and transformed with personal experience and dislocation from the familiar breaks the power structure of the setting. So the simulacra of home blur the boundary between the material and the metaphysical, and the displaced
transnational subjects would need a differential medium to express their psychological association with home. They actually inquire whether home is a face, place, object, or even a person. So in Half of Yellow Sun, apart, even though it's a tale of homelessness, it's narrating, the women characters in the novel are also experiencing the construction of temporary homes in their constantly displacing physical condition. This is also significant loss of safe spaces. So here I would like to stress that space is not static, but transiting certain values and social systems. So Aditi shows how refugee camps, schools, religious spaces, and the like become home, and the architectural and institutional structure of house deconstructs itself into military bases and centers of conflicts following the civil war. So it posits a reconfiguration of refugee spaces as a location to be remembered as well as space to be memorized. So in Americana, Adichie uses transnational home as psycho-emotional quotient, and here the displaced women are continually figuring out home as comfort space of identifying with a significant cultural past. So the racial, so she defines domestic space with a cross-cultural understanding, and the architecture of the house is strictly blurring and merging into many that assimilate the feeling of home, such as the schools and refugee camps, and in Americana, the predominantly black portions of American cities, where it resembles more to Nigeria than to Americana, where they can assume both themselves. So, and the hair salons and restaurants that invoke a sense of root. And here, the theoreticians such as Lefebvre and Decatur determine the potential of space to liberate the citizen from the clutches of oppressive state by the public being able to reclaim their citizen bodies and thus live alienation-free lives. So the possibility of this liberation is utilized in Adichie's narrative, where she continually refers to reclamation of space, the public spaces by the marginalized, as a constructive resistance. So this closely embodies Decatur's argument that mundane, everyday spaces are instances of resistance, escape, and liberation from the grips of state and capital. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you for giving me the time for the presentation.
Many thanks, Amrita. We will now move on to the second presenter. She is Noelle Mariam George. Noelle is a PhD student at IIT Madras in the Political Science and IR department. She has been thinking about Virginia Woolf and the conceptualization of space for quite a while now. I now invite Noelle to present her paper, which is titled Being With, also an exploration of intimate space in the lighthouse through Sloterdijkian feminine spatial metaphors. Noelle, your time is now.
Can everybody hear me? Is the mic audible?
Yes, you are.
So I don't have a presentation per se because I hadn't made one. So before I begin, like, I'd like to mention that I'm not a literature student. I'm actually a student of political science. But I had done my bachelor's in literature, and that's when I started thinking about Woolf and the concept of spatiality. Because we had to do for our bachelor's, we had to write a paper or a thesis towards the end. So it's actually from that point that I started thinking about this. And then when the conference was organized, I was very glad because I could finally think about this in a more clear manner. Because when I was in bachelor's, the way I had written was I felt like it was insufficient, and there was no way I was going back to it because I'd shifted disciplines. But thank you, IIT Madras, for giving me this opportunity, as well as the organizers for giving me this opportunity. So my paper is titled Being With, Also Intimate Spatial Metaphors in Virginia Woolf's To the Lighthouse. My attempt is to ask two questions. What would a spatial reading of Virginia Woolf's To the Lighthouse reveal? And secondly, how useful are the spatial metaphors of the German philosopher Peter Sloterdijk, whose the concept of being with I mentioned in the title, useful to understand Woolf's engagement with space? So Woolf's work To the Lighthouse is a stream of consciousness masterpiece that examines the journey of the Ramsay family over a period of 10 years. While there have been several temporal readings of her work, this paper attempts to understand how she fashions and subverts intimate dimensions of space distinct from her male contemporaries in the modernist tradition. This reading of Wolf is a philosophical engagement through Stotterjeit's first work of the sphere series, Bubbles, in which he explores intimate space through the metaphors that explore the female body as a spatial concept. For instance, concepts like the womb, the placental double, an objective space, etc. I also interweave the idea of French feminists like Kristeva, Sixtus, and Erigeri, who wrote extensively on women in space and who also feature in Sloterdijk's work. I look at how Wolf composes several conceptions of intimate space to mark the 20th century woman visible. This presentation explores three spatial relations. The first being the dyadic relation between man and woman and Cartesian space. The second being the relation between mother and child in Wolf's work and the womb. And the third relation as the relation between the self and the other within a woman, which Sloterdijk presents as the relation between the fetus and the placenta or the alter self. Let me begin with the first spatial relation, which is the man and woman and the critique of Cartesian space. Stream of consciousness as a method of writing disrupts the subject-object binary of Cartesian space. Wolf through the Lighthouse is a feminist rewriting of the classic Odyssey using the stream of consciousness method. In Speculum and the Other Woman, in a section titled The Blind Spot of an Old Dream of Symmetry, Irigaray critiques Western myths and their hidden, I quote, masculine structure that had become phantoms, the trace of Western thought in which woman is defined as a disadvantaged man, a male vestige with no status of her own. To introduce a female narrative was to question an entire framework that had systematically made the woman invisible. Wolf traced a feminine form to these phantoms to make the woman visible. This is why subjectivity plays an important part in the novel. The very use of the stream of consciousness method in this work is to explore the female psyche. Wolf portrays intimate space as if it is a sucking vortex, a curved space that transforms spaces that separate themselves into three-dimensional Cartesian spaces. As Wolf writes, I quote, Mrs. Ramsay, the main character of the novel, seemed to fold herself one petal as close to another, end quote. Mrs. Ramsay is a microsphere, to use Sloterdijk's terminology, who attempts to provide coherence and unity amid chaos. Mrs. Ramsay and Mr. Ramsay, Mr. Ramsay is Mrs. Ramsay's husband, form the man-woman dyad that is similar to that of lovers, but strangely, Mr. Ramsay operates in the Cartesian concepts of space as infinite and time as linear, which makes him think in the binary of subject and object. Julia Kristeva had critiqued such a philosophical position through a feminist lens, as the speaking subject is assumed to be the transcendental ego, detached from history, its unconscious, and its body that underlies any or every productive synthesis. Kristeva critiqued understanding that place reason or rationality within structuralist or formalist binaries and contrasted irrationality or even hysteria, which was attributed to women as those outside of Western civilization. She argued for a post-structuralist view of language and space in which the poetic was not seen as a binary of the rational or the Cartesian space, but rather as a complementary and simultaneously as a disruptive aspect of language. Now I move into the second spatial relation in the text, which is the mother-child and the concept of the womb. Microspheres in Sloterdijk's work are dyadic intimate spaces, like the space between the mother and child, the space between lovers and even friends. Wolf explores in great detail how the mother is the first microsphere through her characters Mrs. Ramsay and her son James. I quote, mother and child, then objects of universal veneration. The book begins with James asking if they can go to the lighthouse that day. His father denies, and James feels a visceral hatred towards his father just moments later, and several Freudian readings of this murderous hatred that James harbors against his father have been interpreted through the lens of the Oedipal complex. While there could be such a reading, a much more nuanced reading of this would be a Sloterdijkian reading that situates James' anger as the rage against the tyranny of the symbolic order of the father that pulls him out of his mother's womb-like presence, or the microsphere. Sloterdijk provides metaphors for intimacy that aren't necessarily sexual. Wolf explored not only the public sphere, but also the private, the inside, the womb-like intimate space. Irigaray argued that making the invisibility of women in public, political, or symbolic space to be an important feminist project. In her work, Speculum and the Other Woman, which I quoted earlier, Irigaray reinterpreted Plato's myth of the cave, in which she presented the cave as a womb, in an attempt to discern how metaphors and language in itself are fathered to become vehicles of meaning, to trace how women were excluded in the production of discourse. Making the hidden intimate space itself is what makes historically invisible women visible in Woolf's masterpiece. Woolf had challenged the semantics of space in literature to the focus on private or womb-like space to deconstruct the very binary of public or private. New language had to be birthed to write of space that was not until then explored or was mentioned only in passing as nothing dramatic. No conquest, adventure, or wars happens inside the idyllic home or the womb. Woolf invented semantics of space within the home womb. That is the first and second wave feminist claim to the idea that the personal is political. In that sense, Woolf was an early practitioner of what Sixtus conceptualized as ecriture feminine, feminine writing through the body, as a method to challenge patriarchy. Sixtus urges, women must write herself and put herself into the text as into the world and history by her movement. In an interview with DW, Sloterdijk talks about the need to birth a new grammar to change the fundamental ways in which we think. He mentions the hidden structures of language, which in turn affect reality, and further argues that we have to birth new terms, new vocabulary, by which we will also have to learn a new grammar. Sloterdijk's spatial concepts in that sense can be seen to be following French earlier feminist interventions, Irigaray, Sixtus, and Kristeva's, in the critique of Western philosophy and in an attempt to recover the long-lost body of the mother and to reinstate the feminine in language. The third spatial relation that I explore is the concept of being with also, which I mentioned in the title, which is the concept of the placental double, an idea that appears in Sloterdijk. And this is a concept that relates the self with the alter self, or the woman with the alter self. In the section titled The Requiem for a Discarded Organ, Sloterdijk contrives the placenta as a primal companion, a companion that was a concept that was prevalent in many spiritual traditions, in contrast to the modern clinical gaze in which the placenta has culturally been excommunicated. He says, I quote, where on the other hand, in antiquity and other traditions, space was often left open for the soul's double in the cultural imaginary, people could up to the threshold of modernity, assure themselves that they were not directly connected either to their mother or society or their own people, but rather they remained primarily connected throughout their lives to an innermost second, the true ally and genius of their particular existence, which is the placenta, according to him. Mrs. Ramsay has, I'm coming back to Woolf's text. Mrs. Ramsay has been read in many readings of The Lighthouse as the nemesis of the second protagonist of the novel, Lily Briscoe. However, I think Woolf's portrayal is much more nuanced, as it is a more dyadic relation. Both Mrs. Ramsay and Lily Briscoe are female characters who are liminal spaces and dyadic alter egos. Woolf contrasts Lily's androgyny, her independence, her ambition, her intellect, with that of Mrs. Ramsay, to point to how women must transform and must incorporate intimacy, emotion, and interdependence with the seemingly masculine aspects of life to become a modern woman, one who fuses the masculine and feminine aspects of being human. The novel, in that sense, is the requiem for the lost double of the female self, as it reassembles itself to accommodate the concept of being within a male Cartesian space. In conclusion, I would like to say that Sloterdijk's intimate, which he often uses to denote feminine philosophical positions and space, help us interrelate spatial metaphors of the female body in writing. However, spatial metaphors can also trap women in their bodies if we do not use the body to communicate, i.e. transform space itself. We do not see this transformative possibility in Sloterdijk's writing, which in contrast to Woolf's feminist conception of space, as she shifts the binary of inside-outside
feminine, masculine, and most importantly, she challenges the spherical womb that contains humans and instead demands that we move beyond the shelter into the formless or the chaotic, I quote, unexplored abyss outside the womb. Wolf births Lily Briscoe, her concept of a modern woman, as she is thrown into a world without the mother, where her canvas provides the site for a transformed conception of androgynous space. While Wolf cherishes the spherological interrelation between humans, she emphasizes on the voyage that throws one out of the sphere as the route to self-discovery and artistic creativity. I've come to the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening to me.
Many thanks, Noel. Let's now have a discussion over these two papers. Unless there's any burning question from the participants, perhaps I could go ahead first and open up these two discourses so that we can further comment on them. Let me go back to Amrita, Amrita's presentation. It's a wonderful presentation, very articulate, and there's a lot of detailed analysis of the relationship between intimate spaces such as the home space and the idea of migration. So while she was reading her presentation and discussing, I was thinking about this idea of hegemonic masculinity. Right. And I was thinking, what is this relationship between hegemonic masculinity and space? Because there are, elements of war, appearing in these discourses. So I was wondering what Amrita's views are about this relation, hegemonic masculinity and the control over space, and how do women figure in this relationship? They seem to be slightly in the margins, right? So if you could comment on that, it'll be very helpful. I think you're muted, Amrita.
I'm really sorry, I was muted.
No worries.
Thank you for the question, ma'am. So I do not need to elaborate on what you meant by hegemonic masculinity, but I would like to relate it to the my paper and also my context. So I have been explaining how there is a shrinking of spaces in while you are in a process of displacement due to something like a war or a civil war. So I would like to pinpoint this the hegemonic masculinity with the shrinking spaces for an for a pinpointed approach to this question. So there are so the public space is something the right to space or the right to public space is something always gendered. So women who has willfully sometimes been in the domestic space has been removed from their everyday domestic space, and there is a new situation on the forefront. So who at present, which gender has to reordain the domestic life, which is very much essential for the progression of any life at any point of life. So men who are also involved in war and who are also refugees are not necessarily taking part in the formation of this domestic space. So that is again left to the women. So usually we think of women in migration as somebody who has to be protected, who is very vulnerable, which is actually true. They are vulnerable. They are not in a very safe space. But at the same time, it's not the men who are actually ordaining an order to the life in their refugee, in their whatever disordered life in the refugee camp or spaces. So it is women who are again assuming the position, again trying to make the space domestic, and by domestic I mean the way of living in that particular space as in like an everyday life. At the same time, the men in the face of war, they have at least some public spaces where they can actually be, and they can drink and enjoy. They can also relax at these kind of vulnerabilities. So there are bars which are open for men, but at the same time, there is no public spaces that are accessible to women. So even at the phase of war or like a displacement, it's men who are more easy to be in the situation than women. But at the same time, there are extra responsibilities that has fallen onto women compared to men. So there is a dominance of men when it comes to the physical space.
But then when it comes to how this space functions, I think it is women who are actually running the space. It's not men. But it is difficult for them to, actually be visible in the public spaces and say like, okay, we are running this society right now. Because men are visible and women are invisible at these times. Even when it is like an, when they are trying to work out the new situation, the new order. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Amrita. I mean, the question of visibility is very interesting, isn't it? I think that'll be a nice transition to Noel's paper, where we heard thoughts about how the stream of consciousness makes the female consciousness visible, in a sense, and visibility in itself becomes a kind of power of sorts, albeit a different kind of power and a limited kind of power sometimes, but it is embedded with notions of power. Noel, again, a very, very interesting paper. There are different ways you kind of enter this question of how this private, intimate space can be a platform for, a negotiation of power, perhaps. My question there is, I was just thinking about idea of biological attributes being, invested with some kind of spatial entity-like, element to it, right? How biology, the reproductive possibilities of the female becomes, somehow spatial spaces of power. And I was thinking about how this could be connected to notions of feminism and how, woman becomes modern through this kind of very intimate space. So can you kind of talk about that, how the intimate space, the bodily space, becomes spaces of power with regard to all these, notions of the modern woman, the new woman?
I'll just relate this to like Wolf's work and what Sloterdijk has to say. So to the lighthouse, for instance, is a retelling of the Odyssey, the classic epic in which the man is going outside to adventure and war and all of this, and Penelope is staying back home. So it's actually a retelling in that sense of a Western myth. And Wolf writes to the lighthouse after the work Ulysses, in which there's also the stream of consciousness method used so as to navigate the city. Like Leopold Bloom is like going through the city as a man, exploring a space. And so I think like Wolf is writing as a response to the classic Odyssey as well as the Ulysses. And she's talking about what is absent in both of these narratives, the modern as well as the earlier classical one, to talk about an absent space, which is the space of the woman or the private space, which during Wolf's time, at least, women were confined to. Like they were confined to the home and things. And I think like the concept of biology having certain spatial connotations which are feminine is something that like people like Irigaray had brought up. For instance, in Plato's, she talks about how Plato's concept of the cave, or like being trapped inside the cave and then coming out, is actually a metaphor for birth. But for some reason, it's like in Greek philosophy and in with Enlightenment and the way in which it is spoken, it's all related to, it's spoken as in a binary, in the sense that the objective space inside the womb is like a bad thing, and then coming out of it is like coming into rationality and coming into the Enlightenment. So she is the one who draws this kind of a space, and then we find this later exploration of this same concept in Sloterdijk, but he brings like various other metaphors, not just the cave or the womb, but he brings like the placental double and several other concepts which I have discussed. So I think like there is a certain liberatory potential in kind of finding out biological connotations of what is the female
like I'm not using gender also, not what is woman's face, but like the female, what is like a female metaphor of a of space which has biological connotations. But at the same time, I think Sloterdijk has been critiqued by many people to not be a feminist. Like even though he speaks about all this feminine space, he's not a feminist because he kind of essentializes it also. Like he essentializes biological space, and there's a certain veneration of women, and you know, a certain aspect of divinity that is given to women. But at the same time, he is also seen as a controversial figure in talking about, in talking oftentimes derogatorily about real women, like speaking against abortion, or like, you know, like women's labor, or you know, rights to equal wage. So this is actually a very interesting position, and I think what Wolf does, she navigates it very, what do you say, in a very, in a very subtle way. By, for instance, like she does talk about the importance of the private space, but she also talks about the need to come out. As a modern woman, we must come out of these spaces, and we must incorporate both of these. She kind of celebrates androgyny, and you know, like instead of thinking about the binary of the public and the private, she says like we need to come out and we need to incorporate both of these, and then transform space itself, so that you know we're not stuck in what was earlier made invisible, but at the same time we're not trapped by going back into only what was limited to women. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Makes sense. Your discourse makes sense here, particularly the point about androgyny, you know, that there needs to be a kind of a hybridity of sorts in order for us to kind of have an equal sharing of power, to put it very, you know, crudely, perhaps. So I think we need to think about the tangible connection to power that women derive, right? So that question, I think, needs to be foremost when we think about a feminine reading or feminist reading, forgive me, feminist reading of text. So what are the connections to concrete, material, tangible power that women get through the intimate space? And earlier Amrita was talking about, you know, home and the root space that these women long for, you know, the longing for the roots. It could be in the home, it could be back in Nigeria, but how is that kind of connection giving them material power? That is a question we need to think about too. All right, I'll stop here with my questions and comments. I now invite the participants to quiz these presenters, comment on, offer suggestions for further exploring their projects. How are we doing for time? We have 5 more minutes. Further questions? I think Noel can also talk, think about a butler. I mean, when every you know, gender becomes a performance of sorts, we know that, right? It's become cultural currency to think about butler and the performativity of gender, isn't it? Yeah. So masculine, feminine, everything becomes a kind of a show of sorts. And for particular ends to be derived, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's something we can keep in mind. And I also like the idea of the home as a space of resistance that she talked about, and how social media becomes a mode of intervention, right? And that can be connected to the stream of consciousness that Noel was talking about. Amrita, do you want to comment on that briefly? Home as resistance?
The major point that I was trying to like put forth through this paper is that how they like perceives home, like home as not like a physical or an like an architectural structure or space, but rather than of like a feeling of belonging, like how you think about it, have you, so I have rightly, I mean, I have stressed on how they perceive home, whether it's a face, place, or even a person. So that's happening throughout in the phase of displacement, because once you've removed your, you are removed from your reality, your ground reality, you have a habit of going back, like as a loop of thinking, like a loop of memories. There is an always a connection of how you connect back with home. So I will take this moment to take a small instance from Americana to like I'll say how home is something very evident in Adichie. So in the character Ifemelu, she is thinking about a return migration, and during the return migration, the first thing that she's doing is that going back to her natural self, going back to her roots by like going to hair salon. So hair salon is a very much important motive in African narrative. So here she's taking a train which moves from an majorly white dominant city in America to an a very African American, I mean even the African dominated space in Americana, a black dominated space. So throughout the transition of the space, the train, there is a train is considered as a transiting space in which the whiteness is blurring out and the root is being connected back. And while they reach back to the hair salon, while she's like tying her hair, she's getting reminded of home. So after a long time, the what appears to be home to her is this to African woman. They are Ghanaian, they are not Nigerian, but they are tying the hair and they're talking about the things that are happening at home. And then that's where she connect to home. So home is as simple as something like a restaurant or a hair salon or in a train for her. So there are like transiting spaces that become home. And even when it comes to Half of the Yellows, and there is like this refugee spaces that are becoming home. So nothing, it is deconstructing the permanency of home as in any kind of an architecture. And what is more striking in Half of the Yellows is in loss of home in the way that their home, which was where they lived for a long time, has become a military base. So what actually becomes home in the face of displacement or at the face of a crisis is very curious. And it is actually the thoughts and the memories. And I'm also reminded of how the structures of refugee camps and all are actually forming and part of memory making. So there is that is actually taken as a space to be memorized than actually being a traumatic event. It's also a space to be memorized. So space, memory, their stream of thinking about home and the feelings of home, and also the physical spaces that attribute the feeling of home, are all important to the discussion of home in Adichie. That's what I think.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Amrita. I mean, yes, the memory itself becomes crisscrossed with exactly. Structures of power as well, isn't it? Yes. Memory and identity. They are invested with emotions, yes. They're also invested with all these structures of discrimination too, which is kind of a subtext, which is not very visible, exactly. But it becomes a subtext, right? All right. Okay, I think we are out of time now. I'm going to bring this panel to a conclusion, if that is all right with the co-host here. Devika, shall we conclude the session here now?
Sure, ma'am. I would like to thank Professor Divya, you and the panelists for that enriching session. It was an interesting take on spatiality and women in popular writings.